Over the last few decades, scientists from around the world have been making discoveries which clearly show that an intelligent designer is responsible for the creation of the universe. Many believe that the entire universe came into existence out of nothing by chance. But if you really think about it, nothing couldn't bring the universe into existence because nothing produces nothing. Everything that begins to exist must have a cause. But many believe that to get a solar system like ours with a planet suitable for life like Earth wouldn't be that difficult. However, many scientists disagree and have brought forth overwhelming evidence to support their position. For example, there are many forces in the universe that are precisely balanced that do things such as pull matter together. Without these forces, galaxies, planets, and stars would have never been able to form. Many stars have been observed to expand and contract significantly. They go from very bright to very dim, even on a yearly basis. Fortunately for us, however, our star, the Sun, has an amazing stability. It does not expand and contract significantly like many other stars. If our Sun did expand and contract like these other stars, it would be catastrophic to life on Earth. Some stars will actually explode violently into a supernova. The debris from these explosions are called supernova remnants. According to many evolutionists, this debris should be visible with telescopes for millions of years. According to scientific research, galaxies similar to our galaxy experience a supernova on average about every 26 years. Therefore, if we know approximately how frequently they occur in galaxies similar to ours, the total number of supernova remnants we have in our galaxy should give us an idea of our galaxy's age. In looking for supernova remnants in our own Milky Way galaxy, astronomers have discovered a total of only about 250. So if a supernova occurs approximately every 26 years as we see from these other galaxies, a total of 250 supernova remnants would indicate an age of around 6,500 years for our galaxy. That's almost identical to the Bible's indication of how long our world has existed. Such a small number of supernova remnants points to an extremely young galaxy, definitely not billions or millions of years old, but rather thousands of years old. To put it another way, if evolutionists were correct about the age of the Earth, we would see tens of thousands of supernova remnants in our galaxy, not about 250. In order for us to exist on Earth, our Sun had to be a star with just the right mass and temperature. Not too hot or too cold. Our Sun generates a perfect amount of energy for life on Earth. The Sun releases more energy in 1 second than mankind has produced in all of human history. If we were to experience a drop in the Sun's energy by only a few percent, all the oceans would freeze. The Earth is the correct distance from the Sun. If the Earth were slightly closer to the Sun or farther away, it would be too hot or too cold for life to exist. The size of Earth is also right, not too big and not too small. We also fortunately have the right size moon, primarily responsible for regulating the tides on Earth. These are just a few examples from a long list of factors that need to be just right on both the cosmic level and Earth's local level, in order to have a planet that could support life. In many cases, if you even slightly altered these precisely balanced factors, life would be impossible on Earth. On Earth, many different forms of life are completely dependent upon each other. Examples are insects and plants such as bees and pollen-bearing plants. If either the plants or bees evolved before the other, they would have not survived. Therefore, they must have come into existence at the same time. The Earth's ocean basins and atmosphere have just the right mixture and balance of gases. If these gases were changed in any way, animal life and vegetation on Earth would die. Evolutionists have no explanation for why the Earth, unlike other planets, has such an incredible amount of water. We also have a planet that is rich in oxygen. If our current 21% oxygen level were just a few percent higher, our atmosphere could become completely unstable and explosive. Earth has a magnetic field. Without this field, the solar wind would blow our atmosphere away. Earth's atmosphere blocks harmful sunlight while at the same time it allows sunlight that is useful for life. Plants require large amounts of sunlight to exist, and a human being's richest source by far for vitamin D is sunlight. When sunlight hits the skin, vitamin D is produced by the body. A lack of vitamin D has been directly linked to many health problems. The Earth's atmosphere also happens to be transparent. This conveniently allows us to view other planets, stars, and things like eclipses. A total solar eclipse is only possible because the Sun is 400 times larger than the Moon and is about 400 times farther away from the Earth. The result is that during a total solar eclipse from Earth, the Sun and the Moon appear to be the same size, creating a perfect match. And it is only because of these total solar eclipses that we have been able to make scientific discoveries that otherwise could have never been made. Evolutionists believe that the Sun, Earth, and Moon formed when our solar system came into existence about 4.5 billion years ago. But the Moon is moving farther away from the Earth each year. So if the Moon were too far away or too close to the Earth at the time humans existed, observers on Earth would never see the event of a total solar eclipse. Thus, according to evolutionists, the incredible total solar eclipse spectacle could only be seen in a tiny window of time in the solar system's existence. Isn't it interesting that humanity happens to exist on Earth during the very period of time when we could witness the event of a total solar eclipse? Another major problem for evolutionists is that the Moon would have been extremely close to the Earth in the past. In fact, the Moon would have gotten so close that it would have hit the Earth in far less time than 4.5 billion years ago. Evolutionists claim that our solar system emerged from a cloud of swirling dust. Therefore, the composition of the various planets and their temperature should be similar to one another, but they are not. Those who adhere to the Big Bang theory actually believe that all matter in the universe was originally concentrated in something much smaller than a pinhead. Then it exploded, expanded, and the ordered system of things we see today came out. However, there are big problems with the Big Bang theory. First, if you concentrated all the mass in the universe in that much smaller than a pinhead starting point, there would have been so much gravity there that nothing would be able to escape it. Second, explosions don't produce order, they destroy order. So it would be impossible to have an almost endless number of ordered things emerge from an explosion. Also, if a Big Bang exploded everything, the planets and moons would be spinning in the same direction based upon a law called the conservation of angular momentum. But we have moons and planets spinning both forward and backward. Comets are also estimated by evolutionists to be billions of years old. Comets frequently collide with planets and the Sun. Comets are called dirty snowballs because a significant part of a comet is made up of ice. When comets travel in space and move closer to the Sun, they begin to lose mass as they are burned up by the Sun. Therefore, comets could only last maybe 10,000 years before all of them would be burned up. Interestingly, other things that could only last around 10,000 years are soft tissue, blood cells, and DNA. Yet all these things were recently found in dinosaur bones. This shows that dinosaurs existed thousands of years ago, not 65 million years ago as evolutionists claim. Another huge problem for evolutionists is the Earth's current human population number of 7.3 billion. How long would it take to go from 2 humans to 7.3 billion humans? It actually wouldn't take that long. In recent history, the yearly growth rate average hit its highest mark in 1963 with a growth rate of 2.19%. The world population is currently growing at about 1.14% per year. But if we started with 2 humans, how long would it take to reach our current 7.3 billion humans using, say, a 2% yearly growth rate? The answer is that it would only take about 1,100 years. Since evolutionists believe that we have been on Earth significantly longer than 1,100 years, why don't we have a dramatically higher number of people on Earth? Also, where are all the bones or graves, considering that almost all people throughout history have buried the dead? Some may still try to convince themselves that getting an incredibly special planet like Earth was just an accident, in which everything occurred in exactly the right way. But even if someone believed this, how would life begin on Earth when it is a fact that life can't come from non-life? All living things on Earth are made up of cells, so what are the chances that even a first cell could have accidentally formed? About 150 years ago, when Charles Darwin was alive, the cell was considered to be something like a simple, unsophisticated, microscopic blob of jello. As a result of recent discoveries, however, we now know just how amazingly complex these extraordinarily small cells are. The adult human body contains 100 trillion cells of various sizes. 10,000 average-sized human cells could fit on the head of a pin, and every single cell contains information equivalent to about 4,000 books. The information for all the cells in one adult in book form would completely fill the Grand Canyon more than 75 times. The cell is similar to a supercomputer but microscopic in size. The cell could also be viewed as an amazingly miniature city, with an elaborate network of connected assembly lines with numerous molecular protein machines carrying out different tasks which make the cell work. For example, in the cell there are little molecular trucks that travel over microscopic highway-like structures carrying materials around the cell. One example of a molecular machine in the cell is the flagellar motor that some bacteria use to swim. It is a molecular rotary motor that has a whip-like tail that can operate at up to 100,000 revolutions per minute. This is a picture of the flagellar motor magnified more than 50,000 times. It is 1/100,000th of an inch long. 8 million of these tiny motors would fit inside the cross-section of a human hair. You can see the details of its construction. It is made up of 30 different protein parts. It looks like it was designed by an engineer. The flagellar motor is extremely similar to an electric motor. Rotating forward and backward, the flagellar motor drives a bacterium through extremely sticky liquid conditions. As a result of the flagellar motor, a bacterium's top swimming speed is estimated to be the same as a human swimming at 60 miles per hour. If that doesn't sound impressive to you, consider that the fastest swimming speed of a human ever recorded was about 5.5 miles per hour. Thus, the bacterium using the flagellar motor can move about 11 times faster than the fastest human swimmer ever recorded. All 30 distinct parts of the flagellar motor are essential, so if you remove one of the parts, it will not work at all, and the bacterium will die. The flagellar motor is similar to a mousetrap. For a mouse trap to work, you need all the different parts, and if you remove one of the parts of the trap won't work at all. The construction process of the flagellar motor requires all 30 different interacting parts to be assembled correctly and placed at the proper locations at the proper time. The construction process also requires instructions, translation, and feedback within the cell at both the beginning and end of the process. If all this does not happen, these amazingly tiny machines or their various individual parts will not be built or assembled correctly. But how would these numerous microscopic machines or parts know where to go and how to build things correctly in an evolutionary system? They wouldn't. It would be impossible. These facts refute and eliminate Darwinian evolution, which is, by definition, a blind, undirected process without either plan or purpose. Cells are mostly made up of proteins. A typical cell uses thousands of different kinds of proteins. To get even the simplest cell would take at least 600 different protein molecules. Proteins are made of amino acids. A single functioning protein is typically made from a chain of between 50 to 1,000 amino acids. Some proteins require a chain of thousands of properly sequenced amino acids. Every time a new amino acid is joined to a chain, it must form a chemical bond called a peptide bond in order to successfully join with the other amino acids in the chain. Left-handed and right-handed amino acids are produced with about the same frequency, but only left-handed amino acids can be selected for use in a chain to make a protein. Evolutionists do not have any idea why proteins only use left-handed amino acids. Every amino acid in the long chain also has to be a specific amino acid. There are 20 different types that can be selected, and they need to be placed in the correct order in the chain in order to form a protein. The amino acids are placed in the exact right order because of a molecule in the cell called DNA. DNA could be described as a master blueprint, information code, or special language that uses a four-letter chemical alphabet. The chemical letters or code in DNA are the set of instructions for the cell's machines on how to correctly assemble amino acids in chains to build proteins. If the DNA is not present from the very beginning, the amino acids will not be correctly selected and placed in the proper order. As a result, a protein will never form and the cell will not survive. DNA can't function without at least 75 pre-existing proteins, but proteins are produced only by DNA. Since each needs the other, they must have come into existence at the exact same time by God. This fact eliminates evolution. A DNA fiber is only about 2/1,000,000 of a millimeter thick. While DNA is not thick and is incredibly small, it is extremely long when uncoiled. In fact, if the DNA in just one of your cells were uncoiled, connected, and stretched out, it would be over 7 feet long. It would be so thin that its details could not be seen even under an electron microscope. If all the DNA in your body were placed end to end, it would stretch from here to the moon more than 500,000 times. If you took a set of DNA from every person who ever lived and placed it in a pile, it would weigh less than an aspirin. Yet the information storage density of DNA is many times greater than the most advanced silicon computer chip. Bill Gates described DNA saying, quote, "DNA is like a computer program, but far, far more advanced than any software ever created. But having the complex DNA instruction program is not enough by itself. Other things in the cell must be able to understand and use DNA's information program. In other words, the highly complex DNA program is actually worthless unless you also have a system inside the cell that can understand the DNA language. To understand this better, imagine that DNA is a complex CD or DVD disc, but if you don't also have a machine or system that can read, understand, and utilize the information on the disc, the disc is worthless. Therefore, other things in the cell need to understand and be able to use the DNA information program in order to build things correctly. If not, the cell will die. DNA is able to make an identical copy of itself. God also programmed DNA to detect and correct errors. There are special proofreading protein machines that constantly travel up and down the DNA molecule looking for any errors requiring correction. If any problems are detected, repairs are made immediately. This whole process is incredibly complex. The information contained in DNA proves that life doesn't just consist of matter and energy. It also contains information. Information can only come from an intelligent source that put the information there. Another function of DNA is that it is the program that God uses to build what you look like, your hair color, your height, etc. As mentioned earlier, each adult human body has about 100 trillion cells, but at your conception you were only one cell. Incredibly, you began your existence no larger than the head of a pin. Yet all the complex information that physically defined you and every organ in your body was there, contained in that one cell. Within 1 month of your conception, your eyes, ears, and lungs developed. Billions of new cells formed and your size increased by over 10,000 times. Shortly after the first month, the speed at which you were rapidly growing slowed down dramatically. If it didn't slow down and your speed of growth stayed the same, you would have weighed 3,000 pounds at birth. After 2 months, you were only 3 to 4 centimeters long, still small enough to fit inside a walnut shell. There is no evolutionary explanation for the incredible complexity involved in conception and birth, or even a reason for reproduction itself. Evolutionists believe the amazingly complex, radically different, yet complementary reproductive systems for all the different kinds of life happen to develop by chance, completely and independently at the same time. Just a slight incompatibility in one of the two systems would make both reproductive systems useless, and life would become extinct. Also, how would reproduction have happened in the beginning if there only had been a male and not a female? How would reproduction occur without reproductive systems or organs before they, quote, evolved? According to evolutionists, humans evolved from land creatures which evolved from fish. But how would the first fish make it onto land and survive out of the water? How did the animals and human beings survive without having organs, limbs, and other things critical to life as these things were, quote, evolving? Also, not one transitional fossil has ever been discovered that shows one kind of animal evolving into another kind of animal. And the so-called missing link fossils, which some use to argue that apes evolved into human beings, have all been shown to be fully ape, fully human, or fake. Evolutionists also have no explanation for consciousness or for the origin of the immune system. For example, white blood cells attack bad bacteria in our body. White blood cells will actually search out and chase down bad bacteria on seek and destroy missions. In order to do this, they must have the programmed information that enables them to tell the difference between friend and foe. Unless all of this was in place and working from the beginning of life, a requirement that rules out evolution, bacteria and other agents of disease would have won, and we would not have survived. Evolutionists have no explanation for the extremely complex, yet perfect, precision in which the body clots blood. Disaster can happen if blood doesn't clot at the proper time or in the proper place. If blood were to start clotting in the wrong place, for example, in your lung or in your brain, you could die. If blood began to clot too long after too much blood had drained or didn't cover the entire cut, you could die. If the blood clotting isn't restricted to the cut area alone, your entire blood system could solidify. Evolution has no explanation for blood clotting. For how would your body automatically know when and where to start the blood clotting process unless there is intelligent internal information to guide it? And speaking of blood, what came first, blood or the heart that pumps blood? Did skin evolve before blood? If so, how did it survive? The truth is that all these things had to be completely developed and present together from the beginning in order for humanity to survive. The 3-pound human brain is the most complex and orderly arrangement of matter in the universe. The adult human brain contains 10 to the 14th power. That's 100,000 billion electrical connections. That's more than all the electrical connections and all the electrical appliances in the world. On the back of your eyeball is the retina. It is less than 1 square inch, yet that 1 square inch contains over 137 million light-sensitive cells, all of which are wired to the brain. The human eye can heal itself and is self-cleaning. The eye also has automatic focusing, enabling a person to distinguish millions of colors. If your eye were off even by a slight degree, you would see double. These facts are just some of the evidence that proves we were created by God. And we find clear evidence of God's creative power and intelligence not only in the design of man, but also in the incredible complexity of animals and insects. This is covered in detail in the video series Incredible Creatures That Defy Evolution. Some believe that the complexity of life in the universe can be explained by the possibility that an alien race created it. But do you really believe that aliens have the power to create the Earth? Or how about something the size of the sun? Over 1 million Earths could fit inside the sun. The sun is also very hot, so how would aliens go about putting the sun together and constructing it? How would they get close enough to the sun when building it, or move away from it quickly enough without dying after starting it up? The conditions outside Earth and outer space are, according to the evidence, too hostile for life to exist. For example, prolonged exposure to the cosmic rays in outer space can be fatal. Just the temperature extremes in outer space would make almost any form of life either too incredibly hot or too cold. There are also poisonous gases, deadly radiation, gigantic explosions, extreme gravitational forces, and the lack of proper atmospheres and chemical elements for life to exist. Yet a large number of astronomers believe that life evolved on Earth and therefore, according to them, it must have also evolved on other planets in space. However, if this were true, many alien races on other planets much older than our own should exist. Some of them would be far more technologically advanced than we are. As a result, they would have sent a radio signal through space that we could pick up, or they would have reached us with their aircraft or robots. But we have never found any alien robots, any aliens, any alien aircraft, or any pieces of their aircraft. Here are some of the reported flying characteristics of UFOs. While in flight, UFOs will frequently change size, color, or shape. Multiple UFOs will merge into one UFO, and one UFO will instantly change into many UFOs. Many UFO witnesses have described these instant changes to the size and shape of UFOs by saying that the UFOs seemed as if they were alive. UFOs sometimes show up on photographs, but other times they do not. Most witnesses of UFOs do not report seeing an object or craft, but an unusual light moving around the sky. Sometimes UFOs instantly appear and disappear right in front of people, and will also pass right through the ground or physical objects. This type of behavior means that UFOs could not be from the material world, but would have to be some kind of spiritual phenomenon. Based on the observed activity of UFOs, many of the world's top UFO researchers no longer believe that UFOs can be from the material world. Also, most of the so-called UFO abductees can only, quote, remember their, quote, experiences after being put under hypnosis, proving that their so-called experiences with aliens were not real. These issues are covered in much more detail in my book, UFOs, Demonic Activity and Elaborate Hoaxes Meant to Deceive Mankind. If ETs really existed, it wouldn't take them very long to discover what they needed to know about Earthlings. As a consequence, they would have already taken us over, destroyed us, or revealed themselves clearly to humanity. The organization SETI, Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence, has been scanning the skies for decades looking for intelligent life. But they have never picked up even one signal from outer space that would indicate an alien race exists. Those searching for ETs have said that if they did pick up even one complex signal, it would prove that an intelligence must have produced it. But why don't they apply that same standard and employ the same thought process to DNA? If they did, they would realize that the complex information in DNA proves that an intelligence put it there. Because whenever you find complex information, it is always traced back to a mind. For the best book refuting the theory of evolution from all aspects of science, including the scientific evidence of a global flood, see Dr. Walt Brown's book In the Beginning. Another interesting DVD is called Intelligent Design: Unlocking the Mystery of Life. For another video that discusses creation, see my video Creation and Miracles, Condensed Version.